Some songs change the world and top the charts. Other songs have more modest showings, but still manage to become staple tracks for generations of musicians, mixers, engineers, and producers to follow. In 1989, Tears for Fears created one of those legacy examples, Woman in Chains. Not only is it a masterpiece of songwriting, mixing, and production, it also carries a powerful cultural significance. Woman in Chains has been hailed as a feminist anthem and actively challenges the topics we'd expect to hear from our male songwriters. Hello there, it's Warren Hewitt here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. Welcome back to another episode in the series. If you haven't already, please subscribe. And if you hit the notification bell, you'll be notified when we have a new video. And if you're into production, you can go to producelikeapro.com and sign up for the email list and get a whole bunch of free goodies. Tears for Fears was formed in Bath, England in 1981. Founding members Roland Orzabal and Kurt Smith had met as teenagers in Bath and quickly connected to one another. Smith recalled, "We both came from broken homes. We were both brought up solely by our mothers, more or less." The pair mutually loved Blue Oyster Cult and their sound. But their first group together, Graduate, had a more mod revival sound. They had received a record deal and released an album in 1980 called Acting My Age, with one single, Elvis Should Play Scar. Completely out of its time, it referred to Elvis Costello rather than Presley. Elvis should play Scar. Elvis should play Scar. However, the song failed to chart. The pair turned towards synth-centered music, forming a new group called Tears for Fears. Smith explained to Vice in 2014 that they attribute their sonic change to the influence of Gary Numan. "It wasn't even so much liking him, it's just that we were kids following trends, and trends in those days were really powerful. You're acutely aware something is changing, and then suddenly Gary Numan was number one. We were familiar with the style, having listened to Bowie, but it was a shock that he was number one." Tears for Fears had drawn their name from the work of psychologist Arthur Janoff. Janoff had pioneered primal therapy with his book The Primal Scream in 1970, and was brought to popular cultural awareness after John Lennon sought him out for treatment. Orzabal and Smith were both fascinated by primal therapy. Orzabal explained, "I think when you're making that transition from childhood into adulthood and you're leaving a lot of things behind, the world is a scary place. We'd previously been in a very lightweight mod band together, and then both of us had embraced Janoff's primal therapy, and we discovered what we do best. Stick out some messages, hidden cleverly in a whole bunch of electronica, and then we were off because we had something to say." While primal therapy encompassed the majority of their fascination with Janoff's work, the pair looked to the more contemporary Prisoners of Pain book when choosing their band's name. In it, Janoff specifically refers to tears as replacement for fears. Their first album was called The Hurting, and it took on deep human and psychological topics. A huge success, it hit number one on the UK album charts in just 2 weeks. Their second album, Songs from the Big Chair, was released in 1985. It hit number two in the UK and number one in the US. It would be another 4 years before Tears for Fears released their third album, but what an album it was. The tracks on Seeds of Love was largely written by Orzabal and keyboardist Nicky Holland. Two of the three singles from the album were massive hits. Sowing the Seeds of Love, written by Orzabal and Smith, and Woman in Chains, written by Orzabal. With Woman in Chains, Orzabal charted a new path in music for the average male songwriter to directly address topics of feminism and femininity. Orzabal explained to the Washington Post, "When I sing Woman in Chains, I'm singing about the oppression of women around the world. I'm also singing about the repression of the female anima within myself, and also singing about my mother. At the end, when I sing Free Her, I'm also saying Free Me." Woman in Chains kicks off the Seeds of Love album with a bass-heavy electronic introduction. This atmospheric section lasts for a full minute before the vocals enter, and when they do, they are both haunting and deep. Orzabal duets with Oleta Adams and credits inspiration for the entire album to her voice and artistry. In an interview with Paul Sinclair, Orzabal explained, In a sense, the germ of Seeds of Love was the moment in August of 1985 when I heard Oleta Adams playing at the piano with a bass player and a drummer in Kansas. That was really the point in which I realized how sick I was of what we were doing. This was our second trip across America playing the same set with the Revox tape machine on stage. And there was this woman I'd never heard of singing in a bar in a hotel, admittedly with her own select audience. Smith likewise had said hearing Adams sing made the duo realize they couldn't go back to what they had been doing before. They wanted to connect with their music again the way they had when they witnessed her performance. This meant bringing in more traditional instrumentation and writing songs with an increased emotional expression. Audible explained, "We were both knocked out by her emotional power. She just cut through the intellect and got straight to the heart. It made us realize that all the machinery and complicatedness we were using were not allowing the expression to come through. It made us go back to the drawing board. It made me want to use real instruments and real soulful voices." In the track, Woman in Chains, we still hear a lot of that electronic sound, but its instrumentation and playing are also more traditional. Audible programs the Fairlight and plays both keyboards and guitar. Neil Taylor adds a guitar arpeggio on the track, and Kurt Smith plays bass. The first half of the song features Manu Katché on drums, but then they brought in Phil Collins to add that big, resounding drum sound. Collins explained, "Tears for Fears just wanted me to do that big drum thing from In the Air Tonight. We want you to come in here in a big way." I had the honor of sitting down with Bob Clearmountain in 2019 to discuss his experience mixing the song. And he told me that Collins' fill was actually made up of several different takes.
And that had Phil Collins playing drums, but it was all chopped up and sequenced. So he used what Phil played, and he'd cut them up, he'd create fills, and he did it all, I don't know how he did it. I think he did it in a sampler or something. I'm not sure, but it was all spread out in a whole bunch of tracks. It was brilliant. But when you put it all together, it all just sounded like a normal. You know, once I got the balance exactly right, because you'd have the first part of a fill on one track and then another part of the fill on another track. You know what I mean? That kind of thing was all stacked, pieced together.
The instrumentation and production of the track, even without the lyrics, illustrates the emotional message of the song. It builds in texture and intensity over the length of the track. The kick drum and Smith's bass, in addition to their individual grooves, come together in the second half of each bar, evoking a heartbeat pattern. This musical motif gives a steady yet powerful pulse throughout the song. As the track progresses, it gains a fullness in its sound, and yet it still feels like the mix has space and room to breathe. There is a constant uplift and a sense of empowerment to the song, even before you realize its message. The complementary nature of the musical sound and the message has inspired songwriters, mixers, and producers since. But of course, the powerful female voice and its ideas are equally important to the song's impact on the world. Woman in Chains has been called a feminist anthem, and its origins may indicate that the connection was intentional. In an interview with Melody Maker, Audible explained that he was inspired both by readings from feminist literature and by his learning of matriarchal societies. Further, he believed that a patriarchal society not only hurt women, but it also hurt men, by forcing them to push aside any emotions and personality traits that might be deemed too feminine. The lyrics highlight these ideas. Audible begins with the male singing voice, "You better love loving, you better behave." Adams brings in a strong female resilience with the lyrics like, "Says she's fine, she'll always cope." The chorus ends with, "Well, it's a world gone crazy, keeps a woman in chains." Listeners have also pointed out that Audible may have been making a connection between the sins of sexism and those of racism. The first lyric from Adams, an African-American woman, references a 1967 play by Howard Sackler called The Great White Hope, depicting American racial tensions through the story of a boxing match between an African-American and a white boxer. In her opening vocal line, Adams sings, "calls her man the Great White Hope." The origins of the Seeds of Love album began in late 1986 at Audible's new home studio. Located in Chalk Farm, London, this is where he and Nicky Holland wrote most of the songs. The whole team headed to a professional studio to begin recording. But after months with a reoccurring lineup of participants, they had nothing that they were truly pleased with. In February of 1988, they headed to London's Townhouse Studio with a new band, having told the record label that they intended to produce the album themselves. They brought in Dave Bascom for a co-producer for the album, with Bob Clearmountain mixing most of it.
The first thing I mixed for them was the other big hit on that album, which is Sowing the Seeds.
Huge song, yeah.
And I spent a day setting it up. It was huge for the time. It was enormous. It was on two Mitsubishi machines, so it was 64 tracks. But tracks were stacked, so there would be like three and four things, different things on each track. And I spent a couple of days mixing it. Roland came in and listened to what I'd put together, and I said, "What do you think?" And he listens to it and he goes, "You know, there's absolutely nothing about that mix that makes any sense to me whatsoever." It's like, that's just...
This is what
so
you wanted to hear.
Completely wrong.
You were like, "Hey,
like, well, okay, well, what do you want to do? You want to play cards?" I don't know. I go, "You want to try to point me in the right direction, and let me see what I can do. I'll do anything that you want, you know." Mm-hmm. And so he gave me some pointers, some tips. I said, "Okay," and so give me like an hour or so, and I played around with it. And he went back and he goes, "Well, that's a little better, but let's make something else," right? Because and it turned out, I realized when it came out, I realized what it was. Because when I heard it, it sounded like a Beatles record, mm-hmm. you know. And I thought, oh, I'll just mix this really dry and up front in your face. It's not soaked in reverb, but it's got a lot more effects and reverb than what I had. And so once it came out, I understood what.
Right.
But of course, in the meantime, he spent, I mixed a whole album in the time that it took him to mix just that song, to remix that song.
Wow.
After that.
Woman in Chains, in particular, shows a complete mastery of mixing and is a lesson for the rest of us.
It's easy to mix. I think I only spent 4 hours, 4 or 5 hours on it, if I remember correctly.
Like I say, not to exaggerate, but the space is really beautiful on it.
Well, it's a beautiful arrangement. I mean, that's the main thing. More so than the mix is... His arrangement was fantastic, and her voice is fantastic. And that kind of dictated what I did. I just heard that, and that inspired me to whatever it is that I did for it.
Woman in Chains is one of the songs that has that sort of feel without being, do you know what I mean? It's definitely produced. It's definitely the choices that were made.
That's for sure, yeah.
But it still has that feel, of depth and width that is really hard to get when you're doing pop records.
Right.
Because, you know, like, wow, the vocal sounds really up front. I've got to bring this forward, this forward, this forward, this forward, this forward. And then suddenly it's, you know, everything's right here. Yeah. And that is a refresher for me every time. Push it down, oh, okay.
Right.
Everything's here now.
Yeah. Well, for me, you know, just generally, mixing is you just can't focus on the details too much. And I think people do. And I've worked with people that will sit there and focus on details for days on a mix. And after doing that for a couple of days, I'm done. I can't tell anymore. Like, I don't solo things a lot. I just solo to make sure everything is, that there's no problems. But most of the time, I have everything in. I always have the voice in, you know, so it's all about the song and the voice for me. And everything's got to work around that. If you're not feeling the song, it's hard to do a good mix. And even bad songs, you can put yourself, even if it's a song you don't like, you can make yourself like it. You can divorce yourself from your opinion and go, okay, what's the dominant thing that people should get out of this? What's the narrative, maybe? I don't know. There's usually something that you can grab onto and just listen to that and don't sweat the details too much.
The Seeds of Love was released on September the 29th, 1989 by Fontana Records. The title track, Sowing the Seeds of Love, had been released as a single about a month prior and had hit number 5 in the UK, number 2 in the US, and number 1 in Canada. So listeners were excitedly anticipating the full album. The album didn't disappoint. entering the UK charts at number one, it was certified platinum within only 3 weeks. Woman in Chains was released as a single a couple of months later, on November the 6th, 1989. It made it into the top 40 in the US and UK, and peaked at number 11 in Canada. But the song has held much more significance than its initial chart showing. In the public sphere, its lyrical and emotional content has made it a powerful anthem for generations of listeners. And for producers, mixers, and engineers, it remains a model track for incredible mixing and production. That is an understatement. I think I know three major mixers, Mark Endert being one of them, who would say that Woman in Chains is the greatest mix ever. Now, they might change their mind from day to day, but it consistently comes up. Its production, the recording, everything about it is absolutely superb. It's like one of those songs like Sledgehammer that you put on, and even though you know it's now, you know, 30 years old, it still sounds absolutely current. It has all of the things that we want in a song. It has a beginning, a middle, and an end. It builds. My hair stand on end thinking about how good that song is. I've been blessed to go to studios all over the world. I have been blessed to go to manufacturers, speaker manufacturers. When I went to Focal and went to their studio tour and then sat in their big, beautiful room with the Grand Utopia speakers, these beautiful, expensive speakers, it was the first or second song that I played. It is an absolute masterpiece on all levels. Again, I'll repeat myself. Songwriting, production, the recording, the mix, the performances, the message, the lyric, everything about it is second to none. That whole album, The Seeds of Love, has a healthy dose of what we love about music. We all know it's got a ton of Beatles stuff in there. It definitely has, but it's done it in a fresh and modern way that still stands up to this day. It's a frickin' masterpiece. If you don't know the song, go and listen to it now. If you know the song, you know what I'm talking about. There's a few times in my life when we do these videos where I connect to my teenage self. And this is one of those. My teenage self remembers this song, remembers finding out, I think whatever magazine it was, Sound on Sound or Mix, trying to find out who made this. I knew the band did it. And I didn't really know that mixing was that much of an art at the time, because most of the records I grew up listening to were mixed by the producers and engineers that made them. But a song like this is one of the songs that I listen to and say to myself, there is a reason why somebody else mixed this. Now, many people have commented on the vocal production in particular and the way it's mixed, that when Roland sings, his vocal comes in right down the middle, and it is absolutely gorgeous, and it has this incredible ambience around it. But when Oletta comes in, she seems to come in above him. None of us really understand how that's achieved. I assume that it's Bob removing just enough of the lows that in most speakers it favors the tweeter more. But it never sounds aggressively bright, but it does seem to raise above. And what an amazing idea. You have Roland singing, and then Oletta comes in above him. And the song's called Woman in Chains. It's pretty incredible. Pretty incredible. The depth of that mix, the depth of that production, every instrument in that just seems to make sense. And the fact that it's, I don't know, is it a ballad? What would you call it? It doesn't need to be explained, but it's not a four on the floor, fast tempo song. That the continually moving arpeggiation that goes through it just keeps it moving forward, that it just washes over you. You connect to every element. And at the end of it, what do you want to do? First of all, you're just so emotional because it's just so beautiful. I just hit replay. First time I heard that, well, I had it on vinyl. First time I heard it, picked it up, put it back on. Third time, put it up, I just kept listening and listening and listening. And once again, as I said a couple of minutes ago, I feel completely blessed that I have had the opportunity to sit down with Bob Clearmountain and talk about how he mixed it. And yeah, Roland, just absolutely incredible. Everybody that worked on that record, my hat is off to you. These are one of the few records that I just wish I could have been in the room just to see how it was made. And once again, what an incredible message, what an incredible lyric, what an incredible performance by everybody on it. I'm just going on and on, but there's a reason. This is considered one of the greatest mixes of all time, and it's in pretty much everybody I know's reference mixes. They'll have like 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 mixes. I can tell you. When Dave Pensado mixed a track for me, I went over there. He had his little reference thing. He had like 4 tracks. Guess what was in there? Yep, you guessed it. Woman in Chains. Mark Ender, Woman in Chains. Yeah. And, you know, I remember interviewing Bob and talking to his wife, and his wife said to me, you know, Chris always, you know, is so like pleasant about Bob and how much he admires him. It doesn't matter who you are as a mixer. Everybody admires Bob Clearmountain. It helps that he's incredibly humble and doesn't have a massive ego. It also helps that his mixes are absolutely incredible. And it helps that he mixed one of the greatest songs of all time. All right, enough of me harping on about how incredible it is. Please let us know, what is your favorite song? What is your favorite song? I think I'd love to know, what is your favorite song? That will be our question, won't it, Lee? It will say, what is your favorite song? What is your favorite piece of production? What is your favorite song? What is your favorite mix? Thanks, everybody, for watching. I really appreciate it. So long, farewell, auf Wiedersehen, au revoir, adios. Goodbye, tutsiens.